divine appearance. Verse 2, and the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. He looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. Verse 3, and Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. Verse 4, and when Yahweh saw that, he turned aside to see Yahweh. Or, I'm going to read it verbatim. And when the Lord saw that, he turned aside to see Yahweh, called unto him out of the midst of the bush, and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. Here am I. Salaki, here am I. Verse 5, he said, draw not thy, Salaki, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereupon thou standest is holy ground. Verse 6, moreover, he said, I am Yahweh, thy father, or I am the power of thy father, the power of Abraham, the power of Isaac, and the power of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Yahweh. Moses' attention arrested. Exodus chapter 3, verse 2 and 3. As Moses tended the flock, the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. As in many other Old Testament occurrences, this angel was none other than Yahweh himself. And this is where I believe that Esau goes off again. Like I said, this is the second time I believe it was in the book, or that kind of Jephthah, where they said it was specifically, you know, the Lord himself. But scripture tells you that, like when you really go into the account of Genesis, it tells you that, you know, the Elohim actually created the universe. And then, you know, when you go in the book of the Colossians, you know, which I could probably find real quick, it talks about how all things were created by him and through, you know, the Messiah. So the Most High is not going to come down here and talk to people specifically. Now, don't get me wrong, you know, the Most High did talk to Moses. But at the same time, like, when a lot of people be sitting up there, oh yeah, I specifically talked to God, you know, so a lot of people be bugged out. You know, here's the account, or to back that up, is the book of Colossians, chapter 1, verse 12. I'm going to read down to 16. Giving thanks unto the Abba, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Verse 13, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Verse 14, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Verse 15, who is the image of the invisible power, the firstborn of every creature. Verse 16, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. So, if, you know, the Messiah created all things, then how is, you know, if, like, basically the Most High is, like I said, sitting on the throne. That's why, you know, if you go on Google, you can Google that image, and you get the image of the Most High, and you get on his right hand side the image of the Messiah. The thing is, who's sitting on his left hand side? So, like I said, that's one of the things that I believe Esau went off on. Oh, another one of the things Esau went off on. Continuing the lesson, the bush most likely was a thorny shrub common in desert regions. The suggestion of some that leaves or berries gave the appearance of fire surely mocks the intelligence of Moses and the power of Yahweh while Yahweh shot. What drew Moses' attention was the bush was in flames, so was not beginning, it's like it not being burned or up or consumed. What this may have signified is love for us to smile. One suggestion is that it stood for the fiery affliction to which the Hebrews were being subjected, but which could not destroy them. First Peter, First Peter chapter 1, verse 7, then chapter 4, verse 12. Another is that it represented the holy God, a holy power, is fire judgment, fiery judgment on the precious of his people, which you can read in Isaiah 66 and 15, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. Isaiah 66 and 15, that is judgment, but that's talking about, you know, the ICBMs, you know what I mean? You're talking about the nuclear war. And I believe Thessalonians or Second Thessalonians is talking about that as well. They're saying maybe it symbolizes God's presence, so they're just shooting at darts, you know what I mean? But, you know, they're trying to use a precept, Hebrews 12 and 29, which, just for edification, I'm going to get real quick just to see what it's saying. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 29. For our God is a consuming fire. Well, that is true. So, for the sake of edification. In any case, the burning bush fascinated Moses. He said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight. Exodus 3 and 3. A thorn bush in the desert was no great sight, not even one that was burning. What made it unique was the fact that it was not burnt up, and Moses was determined to find out why. Moses' worship commanded. Exodus chapter 3, verse 4 to 5. From the midst of the bush came the voice of Yahweh, while Yahweh shouted, calling, Moses, Moses, the use of both Lord, Yahweh, and God, Elohim. Which God simply means power for them. So, and this verse leaves no doubt that the speaker was the angel of the Lord. In verse 2, the Lord's appearance, so that's why I said this is going off, but I'm just continuing to read it. The Lord's appearance in this case was not as a human being, but as a voice from an inextinguishable fire. Moses was left with no doubt that he was standing before deity from within a fire that did not consume. He heard a voice that did not come from a visible person, and the voice knew his name. The repetition of Moses' name indicated the urgency of the message he was about to give. 1 Samuel 3 and 10. Moses answered, typically, here I am. Exodus 3 and 4, proof of Yahweh's presence is also evident from the command that came from the voice that said, draw not nigh, yet they put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereupon thou standest is holy ground. Exodus 3 and 5. First, Yahweh warned Moses not to come any closer. This inhibited his natural desire to gaze at the unique phenomenon. Verse 3. Later at the same spot, Yahweh would warn all Israel to stay away from his consuming presence. That's Exodus 19, verses 12. 13, 21 to 24, and I want to mark that. Exodus 19. Second, he commanded Moses to remove his sandals. This was the symbol of a servant's humility before his masters, and may also have signified the shedding of all human pretense or merit. I don't know where that's going, but you know, that's why we pray on your knees, you know, because they say honor comes before humility. Or Salakia, honor comes after humiliation. Before his master may have said, Joshua was later given the same command when he stood before Yahweh. Using precept Joshua 5 and 15, Yahweh gave Moses the following reason for his command, for this command. The place whereon thou standest holy ground. And it was holy because of the fact that the holy angel was there. You know what I'm saying? That's what made it holy. You know what I mean? But Salakia, I might have messed this all up because at the end of the day, right, Moses was the only Yeah, I kind of fucked it up. Moses was actually the one that actually spoke to the Most High. So that's what made the site actually holy. And then, like I said, when they were in the wilderness and, you know, the angel of the Lord, which is Yahushua, you know, was in a chariot. And that's why it was in a chariot by night and a chariot by day. So, you know, I kind of went off. That's my fault. We just was talking about this, too. But like I said, this Bible positive, as I was just reading the comment of Gideon, and then it was somebody else. And I think it was Gideon, and then it was Jephthah. They said it was the angel of the Lord That's my fault. Like I said, Moses actually was the one that actually talked to the Most High. I'm stopping the lesson.